this evening and enjoyed the city tour yesterday. So this morning, we're going to get started with our final round of sessions. I know a lot of you have some plans for later on in the day. It's the last day of the conference. So we'll try to kind of move through the content and explain everything as we can and allow you to have some time to enjoy the city and the atmosphere here in Sri Lanka. So in today's sessions in the morning, we're going to start off with Austin speaking about maps. And then after Austin, we have Morton from the integration team. And he'll speak generally about interoperability principles. After the tea break, then we'll have the country presentations once again. And then after lunch, we'll have some parallel sessions. And I'll make sure to explain the makeup of those before lunchtime so you know where to go. All right, so I'm going to invite Austin up, and he's going to give you a bit of a background on the different features for maps in DHIS2.
Thank you, Sharjit. Good morning, everybody. Who was happy that it didn't rain last night? Or at least not until later. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about maps today. And if you didn't think there were enough pretty pictures in my presentation on Wednesday, you're in luck, because there will be a lot more pretty pictures and even moving pictures today. So hopefully you're excited about that. But before we get into this, I actually have a QR code here on the screen. I'll show it a few more times through the presentation, so you can, whenever you have a moment, go ahead and open that up. I'll open it separately at the end as well, if you don't have a chance to do it now. But basically, this is a Mentimeter, just a poll to see how you're using maps today, how you think about maps, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. My goal for this presentation is to make you excited about using maps, really like interested in finding out what you can do with them, and to and also to convince you to come to the session this afternoon to talk more about it with me. But before we get into maps, and again, I'll show that QR code again, so don't worry if you don't see it. I just want to make sure that I have a timer so that I don't go over. Is that going to come up there? Thank you. Okay, so before we get into the session on maps, I wanted to talk a little bit about continuous release. So I mentioned continuous release on Wednesday. It's a new way that we release applications. That is separate from the core. So we have the once a year core release that has all of DHIS2. We also release applications independently. And I just wanted to give a very concrete example of why that is useful and how that is helping us to better serve all of you. So earlier this week, I was talking to some of my colleagues from the HISP MENA team, who had an issue in the line listing application with if you had the same codes in two different option sets, sometimes the labels would get mixed up. And so we created a Jira issue. I relayed that to the analytics team, who then fixed it and released a new version of the line listing application. So now that version of the line listing application was released yesterday. It supports 238, 239, and 240, so if you're running any of those versions, you can download that new version, and you have that fix immediately available. So that was something that we talked about earlier this week. 3-4 days later, it's fixed, and everyone can download it and use it. So this is available on the App Hub and on the App Management app within your DHIS2 instance. It's available to everyone. This is just one of the many applications that we do continuous release on. Just wanted to point that out. I think it's really shows the power of this flexibility, because we're not, even though we have a 1 year release cycle, we can turn things around in a week and get fixes to everyone. And also you can update your application without risk to lots of downtime for your server, those types of things. So Mohammed is happy. Okay, so now what you all came to see, which is the moving pictures that we'll get into. I want to first give a lot of credit to Bjorn Sandvik, who has been building a lot of the features that you'll see today, also created most of these slides. I'm just the messenger, so he is the maps expert. And once upon a time, I was working with him on building some of these features as well. So really, really thanks to him for a lot of this. But as we go through this presentation, I'd like you to think about a few things. So think about how would you use these new features in the Maps application? I'm not going to just talk about ones that are new in version 240 as well. We have versions all the way back to 231 new features. So just talking about features that are in the Maps application that maybe people don't know about, maybe people haven't really recognized what the real power of those features are. So we'll talk about a lot of those, and I want you to think about how you might use them, why maybe you are not using Maps as much as you could, because I know that it is something that's often underutilized for a number of different reasons. So think about why that might be for your particular country. How are people already using Maps in your country and in other countries as well? So that's something that we'll try to do this afternoon in the interactive session, is actually go around and have everyone talk about how they're using Maps or how they're using GIS and how they think they might be able to use it in the future as well. And then how can you kind of be inspired and inspire others to use Maps and GIS in new and innovative ways to better analyze and improve health systems, other systems as well. Okay, so the main message here is that Maps is easy to use. It's intimidating sometimes because you think that there's a lot that you can do with Maps. But the main goal of the Maps application in DHIS2 is not to do everything that you can do with GIS or Maps. There are many, many tools that can do that for you, that can are very sophisticated. Maybe you need even a degree in GIS to use those tools. That's not what the Maps application in DHIS2 is about. It's about giving people access to information in a way that is easier to understand, easy to use, and it gives you an idea of how things are spread out in space in addition to in time. So that makes it a little bit easier to parse and to understand and to present this information than it might be on a chart sometimes or in a table. And with that, this is a 15-second video showing how you create a map. That's how easy it is. So you just click the Add Layer button. You select the indicator that you want to add. In this case, we're adding a thematic layer, and then it's done. So that is how you create and this is actually doing something you don't need to do, where you can change the base map. So you have some different base maps that are available. You can add new ones as well in the maintenance application. But this is how easy it is to create a basic map. Obviously, there's a lot of other things that you can do as well. But that if you have an indicator and you just want to see it in space and you've collected data for that, the data elements that feed into that indicator, you can just put it into the Maps application and very quickly show it. So here are the features we'll talk about today. As you can see, it goes all the way back to version 231. So there are some features that were introduced in 231 that maybe people aren't aware of or that they're not using as much as they could be. We have a lot of other new features that have been added since then, and we'll go through each of these and show how they can be used, why they're useful, and talk a little bit about them. So first, as it keeps coming up, we'll start at the end. So we're going to start with version 240, and this is a functionality for basically making a very presentable, printable map. So you can basically lay out the map, the legend, the overview, some descriptive text, put value labels so it actually shows the value that you see there, not just the name, which you could see before. It's a very clean thing that you can print on a piece of paper, that you can print as a PDF, and it really makes it easy to tell a story with your map. And to show that to someone who maybe didn't create the map, doesn't use maps every day, they can. You really want to tell them a story so that they can understand it very easily. So this is just an example of what that looks like at the end. How you've designed this in the interface that I just showed, and now you want to print it. You print it. This is something that you can tell what's going on here, even if you're not a maps expert, right? So you have some text that describes exactly what you're seeing. You have a legend that very clearly says what each of the colors means. You have the different org units laid out on the map, and you have the values displayed there. Also wanted to talk a little bit about different ways to display aggregate data, our aggregate analytics, in the maps application. We've had chloropleth for a very long time, and we now also support, since version 2.35, bubble maps. And these are useful in different situations, and it's important, again, when you're telling a story, to think about what type of visualization you want to use, what type of map layer you might want to use to tell that story best. The one on the left here is best used for indicators, where you have basically normalized information. So if you're dividing, if you have an indicator where you have the number of cases of COVID-19 divided by the population, then you probably want that to be a chloropleth, where it's the same, basically it's easy to compare between one region and the other. If you have just the number of COVID-19 cases, for example, that's a raw number, in wherever your capital city is, will probably look very, very bad. It will look like there is a huge amount of COVID-19 there, but per population, it might not be that high. So there you have the option of using a bubble map, which is for raw values. So this will just show you relatively where the cases are located, and you're just looking at raw numbers or data elements in most cases. Both of these are supported, and you can tell the maps application which one you want to use. So we talked about maps being very useful for displaying information in space. So you're actually seeing how different regions in your country are performing, or seeing the data spread out over that space. But it can also display information over time. So this is showing the timeline map functionality that we have, which lets you see from 1 month to the next, over the course of a whole year, what the different values were in these different regions. And this one's a little bit hard to read, because it's when you see maybe August, it's hard to remember what June or May were looking like. But if you have maybe a single district or something, and you want to see the change over time and see it kind of as a movie or as an animation, that can be very valuable. But sometimes you want to actually just compare 1 month to the other month. And so there we also have the split view functionality in the Maps application, which lets you put all of the different periods that you want to compare in basically on the screen at the same time. So this is multiple months throughout the year displayed with the values available. So now you can compare your February with your January. And this is a much easier way to sort of see progress over time, to see maybe if there's degradation in performance over time. The downside, of course, there is that these are smaller maps, so you can't show quite as much detailed information as you might in the timeline view, for example. And both of these, the split view and the timeline maps, are both available from 2.33. So almost everyone here should be on a version that supports these. Also wanted to talk about style by data element, which is from 2.31. And this is a really powerful way to display information about events. So a lot of times you have events, maybe you have 100,000 events, and you put them on a map, and you just see 100,000 black dots. And that's not super useful, right? Or it can be useful if that's what you want to see, but maybe you want to see something different. Like you want to see the age or the status of the patient that was referred to by this event. And so we have the ability to customize the color of those points and to use values that were collected, data values that were collected in that event, to change the color of each of those points on the map. This means that you can say, as you see here on the left, you have the mode of discharge as the legend, and it will automatically take each of these points and it will adapt it so that it has the color of the mode of discharge of that particular event. We also have the ability since 2.35 to show this information in a table within the map itself. And you can then filter this table as well, but you can see the value, you can see much more detail about these individual events. This is also supported for the other layers. It was only added for events in 2.35, but other layers were added before that.
But this allows you to quickly kind of drill down and identify individual cases, to identify something that you want to highlight on your map, and then to get more information about that. If you have a lot of events, then the colors might not make a lot of sense. It'll look kind of like a rainbow with a lot of little speckles all over the place. So we have the ability to do clustering, which will dynamically group the events together, and you can still see the colors for those that style by data element in this example. So you can see the green, yellow, and blue, for example, and it'll say that there are two events. One of them is orange and one of them is blue. It'll show that in what's called a donut cluster. So this is also available if you have large number of events, to be able to at a glance visualize how many in this part of the country, how many were discharged in this way, and in this part of the country, how many were discharged in a different way. This one is really exciting, and we actually heard from someone, Bangladesh, I believe, was interested in this functionality. This is actually available from 238. It's something that maybe some people aren't completely aware of, but it's a really powerful feature, where for an org unit in your system, you can have not only the geometry or the point or the boundaries of a district, but you can have additional geometries as well that are associated with that point. So the common, this is called associated geometry, is the name of the generic feature, but a very common way to use that is to define catchment areas for facilities. So in addition to a point, which tells you exactly where that facility is located, you can actually assign a region or an area, it doesn't have to be just a square or a circle, it can be a dynamic region around that facility, and then you can use that to say, all right, these are the people that are served by this health facility, for example. This allows you to associate that geometry with that org unit, and then you can do a lot of things with that newly associated geometry or those catchment areas. And I'll talk a little bit more about that as well. There's also an application from an organization called Crosscut. So this is developed by someone that is, it's on the App Hub. It's not developed by UIO, but it's available to everyone. And that allows you to automatically generate these catchment areas, which is a very powerful feature as well. It's quite a complex task to be able to generate catchment areas based on driving time or travel time, and also based on geography, so things like rivers and mountains that might be in the way of someone getting to a facility. So this will allow you to dynamically split up your district based on where you have the points of your facilities so that you have coverage of that entire district split up between the different facilities in that district. And you can actually have multiple org unit associated geometries, so there's a lot more powerful things that you can do here. I wanted to talk also about, so this is still catchment area support, but a little bit about what you can do with that. First of all, this is a thematic map, so you can do anything that you would normally see a point for a facility, you can then apply that to the catchment area for that facility. So instead of seeing just a bunch of dots for the values at each facility here, you're applying it to the catchment area or the associated geometry for that facility, which makes it a little bit easier to read. That's a very simple advantage there. There's also an example on the right here where you can zoom in and turn on aerial imagery, which is like planes flying over, basically. And you can see very detailed information about the houses or the buildings, the roads that are in a particular area, and you can actually evaluate the catchment borders and then go back and edit them if they're not exactly right. So you can use this tool as well to kind of validate the catchment areas that were maybe generated by the Crosscut application. And we'll talk a little bit about that functionality is called ground truthing. So basically you're doing something in the sky and you're trying to figure out if it actually matches what's on the ground to make sure that it actually lines up with the reality. And we'll talk a little bit about also calculating population. So being able to define those dynamic catchment areas around a facility and be able to calculate how many people is this facility serving. We'll talk about that in a minute. And to get to that, we'll talk about Google Earth Engine. So if you were in the climate and health presentation or breakout session yesterday, John kind of gave this presentation already, but hopefully it's still interesting to those of you who weren't there. And this is a layer type that's been around since 236 for DHIS2, and it's really, really powerful. Google Earth Engine can do a lot of different things, and we'll talk about what exactly it can do and also what we're going to continue to enhance DHIS2 to support additional layer types from Google Earth Engine. But this can basically let you show things like population, like building footprints, like precipitation or rain. Land cover is really important as well. You can do all of these things, and you can, for free, go and add these layers and show your information in your DHIS2 instance along with this very sophisticated, detailed information coming from Google Earth. And it used to be a little bit complicated to sign up for this, so you had to actually go and talk to Google directly, and then you would get access to the Google Earth Engine API at some point. We've made it much, much simpler. You can go to this URL, you can send an email to maps@dhis2.org, and we'll sign up for you. Basically, it's free of charge for any country government to set up this system. And it adds a ton of power to the Maps application DHIS2. There's also other things that you can do with it that are very cool. So we'll share these slides as well, so you can follow that link. And it'll give you instructions for how to sign up for Google Earth Engine to get access to this incredibly rich set of data that's available. So what exactly happens when we're talking about Google Earth Engine? We'll see an example of this in a minute. But if you add, for example, the population layer for Google Earth Engine, and you might be elevation layer, there's a lot of different layers that you might be able to use. What actually happens in that case? So you have some district boundaries in your system that are defined in DHIS2. Google doesn't know about those, right? Google knows maybe about some political boundaries, maybe about the national border, but not necessarily about anything else below that. But you want to actually calculate the population within a catchment area for a facility, or the population within a district. So you can, what this will do automatically, so as soon as you add that layer, it can send the organization unit boundaries to Google and then use Google's processing. So Google Earth Engine is not just a repository for data. It's also free processing capability in the cloud to be able to do a lot of very sophisticated modeling and very sophisticated processing of your data. So this is, in this case, you're not actually sending any data or anything too sensitive to Google Earth Engine. You're just sending the borders of the district or the catchment areas, for example. And then it will calculate in detail using the information that comes from another organization called WorldPop that we'll talk about how the world population is calculated. But that has very fine-grained, granular population data at each point in the world. And it will then add up all of those points within the org unit boundary and give you an estimate for the population for that particular organization unit. And then it can also be brought back into the Maps application. You can also import it if you want to use it for calculations, if you'd like to supplement maybe the population data that you already have in your system. It uses a lot of data sources for Google Earth Engine. This is just an example for for population. WorldPop is. You can also use lots of data coming in from NASA, from satellite information, from information about climate. And we'll talk more about the layers that are available there as well. So this is an example with elevation. So you can actually aggregate the elevation within an organization unit and say, what is the maximum, the minimum, and the average elevation? And you can define exactly what values you want to know that are within this particular district. You can also zoom in and click on the map and see the elevation at a specific point. So this is displaying the elevation in yellow to red scale. So you zoom in on the right side there, you can click on that red point, and you can actually see, all right, this is the elevation of this high point in this particular district. So that can be quite useful for a number of reasons, both to just visualize kind of where are the mountains in my country. There aren't very many mountains in Sierra Leone, but in a lot of other countries, there are bigger mountains than that. But it can also be very useful for example, malaria risk mapping. So malaria is typically only found below a certain elevation. So if you want to know where is there risk of malaria in my country, you can actually use this to estimate that. So you can define the values that you want to see, how you want to sort of split up the elevations within the country. In this case, again, it's Sierra Leone, which is not a very high country, so there's no malaria risk. But you could set the minimum and the maximum, and then the steps, so you can see where exactly you're above 1,700 meters, for example. And there should be no malaria risk. I think we have some colleagues from Bhutan here. In a workshop in 2019, Bjorn and myself were in Delhi in India, and presented a maps academy to training on maps and using use of GIS. Bjorn created this map, which is actually using QGIS. I'll talk more about that, which is can do even more sophisticated and advanced processing within DHIS2, than you can do within DHIS2. But this is showing in the country of Bhutan where the elevation is above and below 1,700 meters, so where you should estimate that there is a risk of malaria. And you can see in this case that there are something like 4 or 5 districts where there probably is no risk because it's so high. So that's somewhere where you don't need to target your malaria interventions, for example. Another layer that's available from Google Earth Engine is land cover, which can be quite useful also for malaria, but for a lot of other things as well, especially when we're talking about the climate impacts on human health. So this is showing you what is the land used for? Is it urban? Is it agriculture? Is it forest? What type of land is in each of these places? And then you can, again, similar to elevation, you can dive in and click on a specific point and figure out more about that particular area. The population data that we're seeing here in the Google Earth Engine comes from an organization called WorldPop, and we'll talk. There's a number of resources online where you can find out more about how they calculate population. So we'll talk briefly about that as well. So this is an example of the population, the granularity of the population that you can access through Google Earth Engine, data comes from WorldPop. And what it's actually doing under the hood is it's taking a ton of different information from satellites, from building footprints, from census data, and it's creating basically a grid, 100 meters by 100 meters for the entire world, particularly for the country that you're interested in. And it's saying, all right, in this 100 meter by 100 meter square, it's approximately 60 people. That are living in that 100 meter by 100 meter square. And maybe there's 0 people in another 100 meter by 100 meter square, and maybe there's 125 in one that's particularly populated. It's not gonna be exactly accurate for that one point, that 100 meter by 100 meter square, but if you add all of those up for a district, it can be quite accurate, and there's actually a lot of documentation of how accurate that really is in practice. And importantly, this also, the sum of all of these points will add up to your census data. So it adds up to the official value your country is publishing for the census data for the entire country. And that helps to basically like get more granular than it is easy to do with census data, which is at the high level, but be able to do micro planning and very detailed health intervention targeting at the lower level. So in this example, you're adding up all of these squares of 100 meters by 100 meters that are within the catchment area for a facility, and then you can get the estimate for the each of these facility catchment areas just by adding up that information. So that's what Google is doing for you, because there's a lot of 100 meter by 100 meter squares in each of these catchment areas and a lot of complexity in how you calculate it, but it will do a lot of that processing for you, do all of that processing for you, and give you just the estimated total for a catchment area or a district or a region. Important to note that there is some additional dimensionality to this information that you can use. So we have both sex and age group for that population data in particular, which can be quite useful if you're looking at elderly populations or population under 5, for example, for different programs. And additionally, it's currently based on population data from 2020, which is useful, but maybe you want something that's a little bit more current, or maybe you want projections into the future. And the good news is that WorldPOP is working on that, so we should have estimates for from 2020 all the way to 2030 in the near future. Okay, so I talked a little bit about this already, but this is basically applying that population layer to a particular district and then adding up all of the values within that district to give you the estimate for the total population, which is, in this case, 24,000 in this particular district here. And similarly, you can do that with the area around a facility. I talked about catchment areas, which are a little, you have to do a little bit of work to figure out what is the catchment area for each of my facilities, because you have to think about driving time, splitting up the district in a certain way. But maybe at a very basic, you just want to say, give me the population within a 5 kilometer circle around this facility. So that's something that's very easy to do. You have your facility data, you just add a population layer and say, give me the 5 kilometer radius around each of my facilities and add up what the population is there. Okay, this is another very cool feature that I think has been widely requested and maybe is a little bit underutilized, and that is organization unit profiles. So we have a lot of facilities out there, and they do different things, right? They have different services that they offer, they have opening times, they have, you want to have some information about that facility. You can add that within DHIS2, and you can then visualize it in the Maps application. So this is something that can, basically you click on a facility or an org unit, and then you open up a profile that shows a bunch of information that's quite relevant to you. And this is all defined by you in your system. And you can even have some dynamic data elements or indicators coming from the data values that are entered in your system as well. This one I talked about on Wednesday, but as we talked about the value of population data coming from Google Earth Engine, for example, we showed how you can see that on a map with the Google Earth Engine layer. You can also import it into your DHIS2 system as a data element. So this means that you can have it in parallel with maybe some other population data that you have, but this will allow you to calculate or use the calculated data for the catchment area population as a denominator and an indicator, for example, which can then be used on charts, it can be used on maps, obviously, and many other things. So this allows you to actually import, so this is the Earth Engine import that I'm talking about here. This allows you to actually import data directly from Google Earth Engine, and maybe you want to have a data element that shows the population disaggregated by age, estimated in the catchment area around all of the facilities in your country. It will do that for you. We also have improved support for importing organization unit geometries. We're moving to supporting GeoJSON, and other improvements there as well. GML, which is an XML format, is quite complex, and there was a lot of manual editing that needed to be done. So we're moving to GeoJSON, which is a more modern format for being able to import and define your organization unit geometries. This is just the tip of the iceberg, because as I mentioned, DHIS2 is designed to be easy to use and for people that are not GIS experts. But there are a lot of tools out there and a lot of cool things that you can do with GIS if you are an expert or if you are someone who wants to go a little bit further than what the Maps app can do for you. So you can export the data from the Maps application and then import it into an application like QGIS, which is a free and open source tool for doing advanced GIS analysis, as well as building of maps, generating of new layers, lots of things like that. We saw an example from Bhutan of how you can use that to, in great detail, calculate the elevation profile of a country. And there are many other things you can do with driving time calculations, things like that as well. So just to say, ArcGIS is another commercial software that costs a little bit of money, but it's very, very powerful that you can use as well. You can export the data from DHIS2 to GeoJSON directly from the Maps application. So there's a download data capability when you have a layer on your map. And then you can work with it in another program that you might be using for your advanced GIS calculations. OK. I have a little bit less than 10 minutes left, I think, if I add up the time that before we started the clock. So I have this QR code again. If you didn't get a chance to follow it, please do that now. And then I'm going to talk about kind of what's next. What are some other things that we have coming for the Maps application that you can look forward to? I see some people taking pictures, so I will stall for a moment. Show of hands, who likes maps? Yeah, thank you. Oh, I got two hands in the back, nice. Okay, so more Earth engine layers. So this is something, as we mentioned, there's population, land cover, temperature, rainfall, lots of layers currently supported from Google Earth Engine, but there's a lot more there. There's a ton of data that's available through this platform that you can get access to that we want to make available and make it easily available to people, just as we've done for the layers that we have now. So we'll be looking at adding the ability to define the maps that you want available in your system. So you also don't want to overload the end user, maybe, with too much information, but be able to define, all right, these are the layers that I think are quite relevant and useful. They're available on Google Earth Engine. Let's just enable them. So there'll be an interface for doing that. And then we're adding a bunch of new layer types from Google Earth Engine. Additional types of temperature and precipitation layers, the ability to have Copernicus land cover layers, that's from a different type of satellite. Lots of different types of information that can be very useful in a lot of these programs. We're also looking, and this is all kind of demonstration of potential, so it's not necessarily something that is done or that will look like this when it gets released, but this is really interesting information about climate that can be very relevant to health programs that you can get access to. We're working on ways to give access to it directly within the Maps application in DHIS2. So in this case, we're seeing the history and we had the forecast as well of temperature and weather at a particular point within DHIS2. You can see the history of precipitation. You can see the daily precipitation, which can be quite useful for dengue or malaria or a lot of other diseases that are dependent on that. You can see the change in climate over time, for example. So there's a lot of things that we can start to do to bring in additional information to make it a richer experience for the user of the Maps application without overwhelming them with too much data as well. And just a brief talking about kind of what that involves to bring that information in. This is, again, just an example, but We're bringing in information from local weather stations, from global data sets like satellite data, using processing and data sets from, for example, Google Earth Engine, but others as well. A lot of other organizations that are helping to kind of do the modeling and the processing of this data, and to bring that into DHIS2 to make it available to people. Okay, I'm just going to go through this very quickly because we can dive into it more this afternoon if we want, and I don't have a ton of time. But I just as some inspiration for kind of what you can do with maps, so you can think about what you can do in your countries. Maybe you can share this afternoon what you already are doing in your countries or what you think would be useful. But here are some examples of from an academy that we held in South Africa for the use of maps in DHIS2, showing an example of different maps built by the teams that were attending there. I'm not going to go into too much detail because actually the exercise for this afternoon, first we're going to ask everyone to share and talk about kind of what they're doing with maps in their countries, what they think could be useful use of the tools there. But then we're going to look at these maps and see, can you, without me telling you, can you understand what story this is telling and what it actually is saying with the data there. So there's a number of different examples from different countries. This is Lesotho, for example, of data displayed on maps and how that can be used for action in a health program, for example. Again, I'm just going to go through these quickly so you can see some of the maps that were created. You can obviously print these and use them for planning. You can use them to identify unreached populations, for example. You can use them to identify places that are at high risk of emergent diseases, lots of those types of things. And with that, I think that is it for my presentation today. I'm not sure how much time I have left. Nope, almost perfect, 2 minutes left. So if anybody has any burning questions, you can ask them now. We also have a Maps community. The QR code is there again if you haven't had a chance to fill that out yet. I'll open that up in just a moment. We have a Maps section on the community of practice, community.dhis2.org. We'll share this these slides so you can follow that link, but community.dhis2.org is where you'll find that. And there'll be a lot of more content and trainings and academies and things like that coming soon as well for the use of maps. With that, I will open up just quickly this Mentimeter. Oops. So we had people describing what maps support in DHIS2 means to them. Enough to support needs, that's good. Data visualization, yeah, lots of good things here. Please continue to fill these out because it's useful information for us. We also have which versions of DHIS2 are you running, so that's very useful as we saw the different versions of DHIS2 and the features that were supported there. Interesting to see that. So you have a number of 240s and 338s. No questions yet on what would you like to know about the mapping DHIS2 mapping functionality. So feel free to add this, and we'll talk about it in the parallel session later today. Some good features that you didn't know were supported, but maybe you learned about today. So some people knew about all of these. That's great. How to download a time series map. Oh, that's something that somebody wants to know. That's a good question. We can talk about that in the parallel session later. Great input here. And then this is quite interesting as well, is what are the strength of different aspects of GIS or maps in your countries. So very interesting input there. I know one of the challenges oftentimes is you just don't have data about the org unit boundaries or the facility locations or things like that, because that can be quite a challenge when you're actually trying to do things in the real world and you don't have the digital information to back that up. That's something that's quite important to strengthen as well. Great. I think with that, wrap it up. Any burning
questions for Austin?
Yeah. Thank you. Regarding population displacement,
yes,
especially in conflict areas, how can that be reflected on the maps? It's a big challenge, especially in, for example, in my country, displaced population are not located in camps.
Yeah.
They usually are hosted by relatives or neighbors or so you cannot predict exactly where they are or follow up where they are.
Yeah.
Also, what if your digital data that you base your maps on is old? Like, for example, in my country again, the last census made was in 2004. So it's been a long time right now since we have got an accurate calculation of the population. So
yeah, very good questions.
Thank you.
Sorry, did you have another one as well? No. So the first question is a very difficult one to answer, and it's not going to be DHIS2 maps that solves that problem for you specifically. You can obviously, if you have access to that information somehow, and there are different ways to collect it, you can display it on the map and you can use it for micro planning. I'm not an expert on this, but I know that there are some mechanisms or ways that you might, or people have explored using, for example, cell tower data to estimate populations in a particular region as populations move. So you can actually, without knowing the details of exactly who's connecting to towers, but you know how many people are connecting to a particular cell tower, they can see some estimates of populations moving. Whether that works in different contexts, it's up to it's not entirely clear. That's a challenge that I think is quite. If you solve it, let us know. But also, I think there's more and more research on how to do that and ways to go forward. And I think maybe others have some experience with that as well. The second point is a very good one. So actually, the Google Earth Engine population layer supports it can do the estimation of the population without mapping it back to census data if you don't want it to. So there's actually another option to be able to just, it uses building footprints and land cover and a lot of other information to provide what has been proven to be a pretty realistic estimate of population, even if the census hasn't been conducted for 10 or 15 years. So that can be quite a powerful tool as well.
On the last thing you said, probably it will be good estimates for organized countries like, you know, Western world, but in countries like, underdeveloped countries like my country, becomes very difficult to calculate based on satellite images or extremely difficult. So. And this that's, is a big challenge here.
It is a big challenge, but there's actually a whole presentation on YouTube that I can send to you that the founder of WorldPop gave a presentation on how they actually do this. It's very complicated, but they do it specifically targeting actually low and middle income countries and a lot of countries that have more informal settlements and things like that as well. So it is something that you can get, it's not gonna be 100% perfect, but you get a good estimate of the population even without any other data than what's available from satellite. We can share more information about that as well.
Thanks. So just one last question for Mohammed. I know there's other questions probably, but
we have a session this afternoon.
Yeah, Austin has a dedicated
yeah,
session.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, Austin, for nice presentation. Just a reflection about the good and the smart question from Najib from Yemen. So we can, in his question, we can uncover one of the DHIS2 feature, let me say, or power, by presenting a program indicator about the assigned population for a certain facility where we have the owner organization unit and the referral organization unit. So if we adopted the concept of family practice, for example, and assigned population for a certain area and knows the owner organization versus referral organization. So the GIS in this case is the vehicle. So the issue, how to put the good passenger, to put them inside that vehicle in a proper way. So in the design phase, this is the public health work, while yani, we are working on designing this program indicator in this way, at least we can maybe show some indicators might help the decision maker to see the displaced people, crowdness, and let me say the overwhelmed health facility as a result of displaced people. So there is a workaround solution for that. Could be utilized by the vehicle, the GIS. Yep. Thank you.
It's complicated. It's a challenge. It's a challenging. Yeah, it's a challenging one. There's some proxy indicators that you can use as well to kind of get some estimates, but it really depends what data you have available. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So a big thank you to Austin.
Thank you all.
Okay, and I'll invite my colleague Morton to come up to give us a bit of a discussion on interoperability.